one-fifth the world's supply of surface fresh water, the Great Lakes stretch 1,000 miles across the heartland of the continent. Their waters flow from Lake Superior in Michigan into Huron. From there, through Lake St. Clair and into Erie. Then on through Lake Ontario and out the St. Lawrence River to the Atlantic Ocean, providing drinking water for hundreds of communities and millions of people, food and recreation for millions more, transportation for the commodities of two nations, and a source of cooling water for electric power plants and industries. But in the last 200 years, increasing human population has amplified our use of these waters 1,000-fold. Wastes from the cities and industries of 8 states and the province of Ontario flow into the lakes and their tributaries. Runoff from cities and farmland throughout the basin carries heavy loads of nutrients into the lakes, over-fertilizing the water and affecting aquatic life.
It's well known that the Cuyahoga River in Cleveland would burn from time to time due to the oil slicks.
The press focused public attention on these pollution problems, and Lake Erie became the national symbol for environmental degradation. In response to public pressure, pollution control laws were put into effect, and funds became available for scientists to collect some of the basic data that would help them understand the lake and its problems. The other Great Lakes also benefited from the public attention directed at Erie. A new general concern for the lakes brought support for research projects which would help scientists understand some of the complex relationships between natural processes and the way people use the lakes. The 1960s marked a turning point in Great Lakes history, for in the 70s, some of the most polluted areas in the basin began to show signs of recovery. In 1972, President Nixon and Prime Minister Trudeau signed a water quality agreement between the United States and Canada, which pledged both countries to protect and restore the Great Lakes.
Most of the problems that we've faced in the Great Lakes to date,
Rich Thomas,
we have found after the fact. We have always been in a catch-up situation that we found a contaminant many years after it's been in place. That we have not predicted that, for example, with the opening of the various seaways into the Great Lakes system, that this would result in an influx of an exotic or more than one exotic species of fish into the Great Lakes. These have in the past been non-predictable, but since we have worked on them, we have achieved some level of understanding of the consequences of the actions we've taken in the past. If you change one thing, it may have an effect upon the other things within the lake itself, a reverberation that is occurring within the Great Lakes aquatic ecosystem.
The challenge is to balance present and future needs of the people of two nations with the uncertain requirements of a vast and fragile ecosystem.
So many good things have happened in the last 50 years. The commercial fishing industry was almost wiped out because of the invasion of the sea lamprey and overfishing and changes to the ecosystem. Because of good sustainable fishery management decisions, you know, we have a fishery again.
Based on the work from people before me that have laid down a good foundation where people trust Sea Grant, people look to Sea Grant for information, being part of that sort of organization is really rewarding.
Collectively and collaboratively, we are attempting to move all of these fields in a direction that is going to be better for society today and the people that are going to be living in Wisconsin 50 years from now.
I think it's really important to use both social science and natural and physical science to further define the problem and then to come up with a solution.
I think that we're starting to see this greater appreciation for science that values things like traditional indigenous knowledge. I do hope that we continue to work to value and center voices of the most vulnerable or marginalized populations, especially when it comes to climate change, because those are the folks who are going to be impacted the most.
Everything is touched by a changing climate.
because we are really a freshwater rich area, we could potentially be a place that people move to in the future. And, you know, what are these kind of competing interests for what the lakes will be?
It's going to be very important to have this trusted source of scientific information to help communities make the best decisions possible.
I really believe that we need to talk about hope, and we have to give people a strong vision of where we want things to go, because as soon as we do that, we start moving towards it rather than focusing on the negative things that have happened in the past.